Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Northern Nevada, where it is our mission to grow in love, faith, justice, and joy. My name is Gaia Brown. My pronouns are she, her, and I'm honored to be serving as your worship associate today. We are meeting on the ancestral lands of the Paiute, Shoshone, and Washoe tribes, who have stewarded this land for many years. We owe a profound debt to our indigenous neighbors. And with that in mind, I welcome you to this place. Whether you are inside the great room or on the Zoom airwaves, we welcome you regardless of racial identity, age, economic circumstances, immigration status, sexual orientation, gender identity. If this is your first time here, or your 101st time, we're glad you are here. Newcomers can sign up for the weekly newsletter that keeps us all informed of the many happenings at UUFNN. And if you miss doing so coming in, please make sure you stop at the welcome table on the way out. We ask that all respect the wishes of folks who choose to continue to social distance, and please be intentional about honoring the personal boundaries. For those of you on Zoom, you will remain muted during the service, but you can put comments into the chat box, and you can also stay on following the service for coffee time and conversation. So no matter where you are today, you are welcome to this community. And now Nathan has some announcements for us.
Good morning. My name is Nathan Bakken. I use they, them pronouns, and I am the director of congregational life here at UUFNN. I have about four announcements, and then I'm going to invite some folks up as well. My first announcement is from the Reno Posse. The Reno Posse makes 175 dinner bags each week. Each one contains a dessert. Right now, we need help with that. After the service today, you can pick up a kit that will provide 20 desserts. No measuring needed, and return it right here at the church. Thank you for helping feed our hungry neighbors on the street. And if you have more questions, you can talk to Jane Dunn. Jane, could you raise your hand? Thank you. Our next announcement is the Reno Sparks Heat Mapping Project. It needs volunteers. Next weekend, on the 10th or the 11th, Reno is the fastest warming city in the United States. We need to support and help scientists, policymakers, and community groups better understand heat in Reno by volunteering as a driver or navigator for the Reno Sparks Heat Mapping Project. There's a flyer with a QR code for more information in the gathering room. And if you have additional questions, you can reach out to Michelle Hamilton. Michelle is standing right there in the back, waving on our tech team today. Woo! Also this weekend, if you don't have time to be a driver for the heat maps, here at UUFNN, we are partnering with Return Strong, and we are hosting an event titled States of Solidarity. We are honored to invite you to an impactful, transformative event hosted by Return Strong as part of our 2024 community education program, States of Solidarity Nevada. The event highlights include a panel discussion with three organizations, Survivors Speak, Legal and Policy Perspectives, and Alternatives to the Solitary. These panels will center folks with lived experiences, advocates, and mental health and legal experts all around solitary confinement here in Nevada. There will also be an experiential art exhibit in which you can it's a powerful art exhibit featuring works created by solitary survivors, their families, and currently incarcerated individuals, as well as a tour of a replica of a solitary confinement cell. So you'll be invited to step inside a replica solitary confinement cell to gain the visceral understanding of the conditions experienced by those in isolation. This experience aims to foster empathy by allowing participants to witness the stark realities of solitary confinement. There are flyers in our lobby. That event is happening on Saturday here, August 10th, from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. And there's more information in the gathering room. And finally, Pride is September 7th, and UUFNN, woo! UUFNN is having a booth in the festival, as well as we are walking in the parade. If you are interested in volunteering, either tabling for us or participating in the parade, there will be signups in our e-news, and you can email me for more information. And in the vein of Pride, many of us here have heard the news that Drag Queen Story Hour has been canceled at the Washoe Public Libraries due to harassment and retaliation from far-right extremists. Our center is partnering with local communities, including UUFNN, to continue the work of Drag Queen Story Hour. So we will be hosting Drag Queen Story Hour in November, as well as in May. So keep your eyes out for more information regarding Drag Queen Story Hour. And finally, in the gathering room, you will find flyers for the No More Trauma Tour. UUFNN is partnering with Flamey Grant, a post-Christian drag queen folk singer, to offer a drag queen folk concert here on October 20th. The pre-sale tickets are $15. It's $20 tickets at the door. Doors will open at 7:30. There's more information in the gathering room. And if you're interested in buying a ticket, you can reach out to Carol at office@uufnn.org. And those are all my announcements. Big exciting things happening at UUFNN. And with that, I would love to invite Shun up to talk to us about Nevada balloon rides.
Howdy. My name is Shun Ma. My pronouns are he and him. I'd like to share with you my experience as a member for UUFNN for about 5 years. When I first joined, one of the first things got us really excited. Any new members here, by the way? Yes? Oh, great. All right. So, later on, you get to meet Sheila. It was one of the first experiences I had. I met Sheila in the gathering room, and she was telling me, oh, we had an auction, and here are some of the leftovers. Are you interested? And I said, well, of course, we want to meet people. And that started us down the path of being involved with UUFNN's auction activity. Well, last year, 2023, my wife bid and won a hot air balloon ride for me. It was for a Sunday ride in September. I had to be at San Rafael Park at 5 a.m. in the morning, and it included a reserved parking pass. And for those of you who have ever been to the balloon race, that is choice, okay? So with that in mind, Michelle, are you ready? I'd like to share with you a little bit of my views. That's Philip Moore on the left, in case you're wondering. The balloon being inflated. That's kind of what you hear going up. It gets kind of quiet when the burners aren't running. That's the pilot. I'll tell you that a little later. And during the course of the ride, it's just you and the pilot, so it's pretty quiet. as you get a little higher up, and a little higher up, and some of the views you get to see. You know, casino land. And those are some of the small shots that I got. Hey, needless to say, it was an awesome adventure with really great views. The night glow show is choreographed to music, and if you haven't seen that, that is awesome all by itself. The skies were blue, the winds were calm. It is a race. It's called the Reno Great Balloon Race because there, in fact, is a prize for the pilot that can get closest to the X. And if those are really interested, I can show you where that X is later on. It's the pilot's skill that determines where the crosswinds and the thermals are. And you can end up anywhere miles away from where we originally started. Fortunately, our pilot was very good. He ended up right back in the park. I didn't have to go very far. That was a real trip. The trip lasted for about an hour aloft, and you'd be amazed how quickly that time goes by. I want to let you know that you have an opportunity to have the same experience this upcoming fall. We're going to have for our autumn auction early bidding starting next week, Sunday, August 11th. One balloon ride, three in total, will be offered each for the next 3 weeks. So the Friday, September 6th ride will be bid from open for bidding from August 11th to the 17th. The Sunday, September 8th ride from August 18th to the 24th. Saturday, 9th, 7th ride from 8:25 to 8:31. I know there's a lot of dates. We can talk about it later. Not a problem. It's just to let you know, for the upcoming 3 weeks, you'll be reminded you have an opportunity. We really want you to go ahead and bid. I'll be in the great room with the donation station for the auction for questions for you afterwards. We hope you all have a chance to participate. Thank you so much.
And I am the Sheila that he met. Actually, I met a ton of people through the auction. I'm looking out here now, I'm seeing Billy Lee. That's the first thing I ever talked to Billy Lee about. It's just what I did for a long time, because this auction has been at UUFNN for about 15 years. One of our auctioneers is sitting right up here in the front row, Mr. Dave. This year, everything is online. So that's why, and the only thing that will be different about the bidding is that, as Sean said, we have early bidding for the balloon rides because the balloon rides have to take place that first week in September, and the bidding isn't until the first through the 7th of September. But first of all, what I want to talk about today is the thing that we need to make a successful auction are donations. And so we're opening, and we will keep open for the whole month of August what we call the donation station. You need to come and see whoever is sitting there today. It happens to be me and Bobby Ma over here. Bobby is the expert on our software. We have wonderful software that you'll be able to access online and bid on. And you should have received messages already from the software. It's Octria. But if you are thinking, well, I don't have anything to donate, what could I donate? You come and see me and Bobby, because we'll tell you what to donate. We'll give you ideas. I had somebody writing up a pie this morning. She's going to donate a pie to the highest bidder, and it'll feed 8 people, and you give a party, and you'll have a pie. And there will be a lot of stuff like that. But the most valuable things that you can donate, and this fits the theme today, which Nathan is going to talk about, the theme of community and hospitality. Hospitality and community, the things that are the best auction donations are those that bring us together as people. Going to a dinner, the Ma's have given a couple awesome dinners. I met Dave Hutchison at one of them. I didn't know Dave, and now I did, because I sat by him at one of these auction dinners. So those are the best. Of course, we'll have other things, baskets and stuff, but the true donations, think communication and community. I don't want to ignore the Zoom people here, because the Zoom people, if you want to donate something and you don't know how to do it, there is an email address easy to remember, auction@uufnn.org. You can write to that anytime and somebody will help you with donations. Right now we're focusing on donations, and I bet you we'll be talking about bidding here soon. But now, come to the donation station. Thank you. Thanks for time.
In just a moment, it will be time to greet each other. If you have a joy or sorrow that you would like shared later in the service, please fill out a white form. They're in the basket in the back, or you can ask an usher to help you find one. And bring this form to Nathan or me during our greeting time. Now, please take a few moments to greet one another in whatever way is most comfortable for you, a hug, handshake, wave. If you're on Zoom, you can wave to each other. When you hear the singing bowl, you know it's time to return to your seat.
Good morning. As a reminder, my name is Nathan Bakken. I use they, them pronouns, and I am the director of congregational life here at UUFNN. Here at UUFNN, we open all of our services with a chalice lighting, a symbol of our faith. And Dave, could you help me light the chalice? As Dave lights the chalice, I invite you to hear these words. We light our flaming chalice each week with a simple spark to make holy our time together. With this flame, may our highest intentions be refreshed. With this flame, may we remember who we are and whose we are. With this flame, may our faith be renewed and reignited to guide our journeys. Amen, and blessed be, and namaste. When I was thinking about what this service needed to be, I read these words by the Reverend Bob Janice Dillon. You have come through these doors and into this place. You have come to be with others who care about what it means to live on this beautiful blue-green world. You have come to be with your innermost self, to hear the deep wells within you brimming with courage and vision. You have come to rest in the sacred. Rest in the divine silence to be renewed by not having to be anyone other than who you are right now. You, one small part of the eternal cosmos. You have come here to cry out, to rattle the walls that contain all the prisoners of injustice and greed and isolation, and when the time comes to tear those walls down. You are welcome here. The world needs a few people who are honest, even to the point of accepting their imperfection. The world needs a few people who are brave enough to risk individual comfort for the sake of a larger love. The world needs a few people who honor their own pain while simultaneously remaining open to the transformation of pain to wisdom and compassion. The world needs a few people who step into the unknown carrying enough love to make things interesting. The sign-up sheets to come to this place are not on any wall, but wait eternally within the human heart. So we gather in peace to let us make room for the infinite possibilities of the Spirit. So welcome, friends, beloved community, to this hour and to this place. As I reflect later in the service on hospitality, what it means to gather in this place as a community means to show up in however you show up, and we welcome you. And in the spirit of that welcome, I invite you all to rise in body or spirit for our opening hymn in the gray hymnal, number 361, Enter, Rejoice, and Come In.
Come on.
And as we enter and we rejoice and we come to this place, we ground ourselves in the truth that with joy we are able to hold sorrow. I want to invite everyone to find a posture that feels grounding, that feels centering for you, whether that be your feet on the floor or feeling the back of your chair against your spine. It might mean closing your eyes or softening your gaze. But to ground us in our time together, we remember that we, as humans, are able to hold so many things. And as we enter into this time of contemplation, where the joy of our opening hymn meets the quietness in our heart, we take this time to lift up for peace in Palestine, for peace in Israel, for peace for all innocent people. For we know to be true that no one ever really wins any war. And we remember that on this planet, we are not the center of attention. That we remember the whole interconnected reality of our world. As we hold and remember the dogs and cats at our shelters here in Reno and Sparks in Northern Nevada, as they are filled to capacity. That there may be an invitation to welcome a new being into your home. And as we imagine the growing capacity of welcome, we celebrate with joy, with Nancy Ann Leader and her family as they welcome Charlie Visser, who was born on August 2nd at 12:12 a.m. and is Nancy Ann's 12th great-grandchild. And as we bring ourselves back to center, I invite you to reflect back into the silence of your own heart. That in just this brief time, we have held so many things together. That the resiliency and the capacity of the human spirit is not one that is fragile, but rather one that is welcoming. That is seeking connection with others. And so to bring our time together to a close, I invite you to take three breaths. They may be as deep or as shallow as you need in this moment. As you breathe, breathe in that welcoming spirit. That just as you welcome those around you, you welcome yourself. And from that place of welcome, we move forward in community and in connection. Amen, and blessed be, and namaste. Before I begin my reflection today, I want to invite all of us just to stretch. Take a moment, be courteous to those around you, no need to elbow anyone in the face. But take a moment to enter into this conversation this morning connected to your body. To begin our conversation today on hospitality, I want to invite you all to ground in this quote from the Irish philosopher Richard Kearney from his book Anatheism, Returning to God After God. Kearney's work, like Unitarian Universalism, encourages an interfaith dialogue when wrestling with life's big moral and ethical questions. In Anatheism, Kearney meditates on the necessity of our differences in creating a universal or interfaith hospitality, or as he calls it, an interconfessional hospitality. Interconfessional hospitality means respecting the otherness of each other as much as acknowledging something common to all. For without the former, without the otherness, there would be no guests to invite and no host to receive. In other words, it is not enough for religions to distill overlapping moral elements into one synchronistic brew without the appreciation of the deep confessional and cultural diversity, without that appreciation of deep confessional and cultural diversity, there can be no real sense of hospitality at the work between religions. And I want to repeat, without recognition of difference, there can be no experience of the stranger and no opening to what is not ourselves. And I'm going to repeat that last line. Without the recognition of difference, there can be no experience of the stranger, and so no opening to what is not ourselves. In other words, hospitality requires us to not stop at simple common ground or similarities, but that we must find a way to honor the truth that we are all simultaneously and fundamentally different from one another. Just as we know one another through our similarities, we too are strangers to one another. That is easier said than done. More often than not, we look out towards the world and see unending waves of hostility at the difference of the world. Even just this past week, Aman Khalif, a cisgender Olympic boxer from Algeria, has been placed under misogynistic and transphobic microscopes because of how powerful she is and how she fails to perform Western standards of womanhood and has rendered her as dangerous in the world of women's sporting. It is difficult to hold a posture of hospitality in a hostile world. In part because our world reminds us that we, to quote Vice President Kamala Harris's mother, Shamalaya Gopalan, we exist in the context in which all we live and what came before us. We carry the stories of hostility and hospitality in our bones. We carry the stories of hostility and hospitality in our language. For people who are new here, I begin every reflection I write by looking at the etymology of a word just to refresh myself, and sometimes I find little gems. Because the etymological root of any word helps me understand the context in which those words live and what context came before them. So imagine my surprise when I came across the fact that hospitality and hostility share the same common root word. Way back in 4500 BCE, when the Proto-Indo-European languages were being spoken, we had a word named gosti. And gosti translates to stranger. It translates to stranger, guest, and host. And over time, as the languages of Europe evolved, ghosty split in the invention of Latin and became two words, hostis, meaning stranger, foreigner, and public enemy of the state, and hospis, meaning guest, visitor, stranger, and the provider of care. Ghosty, through thousands and thousands of years of linguistic evolution and tradition and culture, gave us the words hostile, that is, and gave us the words hostile and hostility, the words we turn to describe a situation that is aggressive, violent, defensive, or mean. Ghosty also gave us the words hospitality and hospitable, the words we turn to convey care, community, connection, and support. These cousined antonyms are connected through the evolution of language in an attempt to help us describe and meet those who are unlike us. Stranger is at the heart of both of those words. As Unitarian Universalists, we lift up and find inspiration and meaning in the wisdom traditions across and beyond the religious landscape of our world. Like Kearney's invitation, we are called to bring traditions together and rest in their conversation. So we are not lacking in stories passed down throughout the millennium about how we are called to meet and receive strangers. In the Roman poet Ovid's Metamorphoses, he tells the story of Bacchus and Philemon, a couple living in a land that has forgotten the rules of sacred hospitality, and when the gods Jupiter and Mercury appear in disguise, they are shocked to find one place that they are welcomed. In the book of Genesis, we find that infamous story of Sodom and Gomorrah, where three angels are disguised as strangers and wander into a town only to be received by one family, Lot. Though that story did not end in much of a celebration, Lot's family was spared because of their hospitality, though I could preach a long sermon on how complex that hospitality was because it's not a fun story. In the Quran, one of the central teachings of Muhammad is that Islam began as a stranger and it will become a stranger. So blessed be all those who are strangers. How many here are familiar with the Golden Rule? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you comes out of the Christian and Jewish traditions, but that sentimentality, that wisdom, appears in almost every single religious and spiritual tradition. Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, Hinduism, Taoism, Confucianism, Zoroastrianism, and Wicca all have different articulations of that sentiment. And that sentiment could easily be rewritten as, do unto strangers as you would have them do unto you. One of the greatest gifts of religion is that it has challenged us over thousands of years to move beyond our biases and cultivate empathy, understanding, and place for people who are nothing alike. I will also say, they're not perfect at it. But ultimately, this wisdom leaves us in our state of free will and agency to live into a choice, to live into the legacy of ghosty. When we meet a stranger, do we choose hospitality or hostility? Our Unitarian Universalist forebearers and leaders basked in the wisdom of all these stories and created our first principle, that we recognize the inherent worthiness and dignity of every person. They did not write, we recognize the inherent worthiness and dignity of every person like us. Nor did they write, we recognize the inherent worthiness and dignity of every person who reciprocated our hospitality. To return to Kearney, hospitality means respecting others, the otherness of each other, as much as acknowledging something common to us all. For without the former, there would be no guest to be invited, nor host to receive. How do we cultivate hospitality that respects the otherness of the other? The first step is what I call discernment. In order to welcome someone fully, we must first be in a place to welcome them. You do not invite someone into your house when your kitchen is on fire. Discernment honors the power differences between all of us and honors the vulnerability of hospitality. It requires our agency to say yes and our agency to say no. This past weekend, I had lunch in South Lake Tahoe with two of my friends from college, college and grad school, who are currently hiking the PCT. They are both trans and queer and Latinx and dark-skinned. And I asked them how they handle the fact that hitchhiking is a necessary part of the hike. They told me how the first time they had to hitchhike back in mid-April, it was terrifying. My friend was overly precautious, but I would argue, they said overly, I would say they were correct amount of precautious, of taking pictures of the license plates, texting their friends and family saying, I'm getting in this car, this is the license plate, this is the name of the person driving, I need you to know where I'm going. Then they told me that eventually you have to learn to trust the person driving the car, that they are going to be hospitable and follow through on their commitment to take you where you need to go. They told me that you need to build trust in the risk and accept the fact that being open to hospitality, being open to the hospitality of a stranger, is necessary to achieve their goal of completing the PCT. They also told me that they said no to people, that there were situations where they discerned, actually, I cannot receive hospitality from this person. It requires us to discern and ask, are we in the place where we can do the work of risk-taking? And if the answer is no, we say no. We hold our boundaries and communicate to the person. My friends hiking the PCT also reflected on the truth that we are all simultaneously the extender and receiver of hospitality. If you've been sitting here this morning only thinking about yourself as a provider of hospitality, I'm going to invite you that we take our savior complex and we put it on the shelf. And we need to humble ourselves because there are always moments where we have to take the risk of trusting another person who we do not know that well. The second step in practicing hospitality is accepting the fact that we are different. Difference itself can be the common ground in which we find connection. I am similar to all of you in that I am not similar to some of you. We are living in a world where the fact that we are different is met with hostility. That our lived experiences are not the same is met with hostility. That people who choose not to have children are met with hostility. That people who are racialized, sexed, express themselves in ways outside the norm, people who are disabled, people of religious minorities, people who are unhoused, are immigrants, are undocumented, are incarcerated, are poor, are met with hostility. And that is a story we know too true in Reno. Yet, to become a hospitable place means that we need to accept those differences. That we do not ignore or erase parts of ourselves or others to find a place of belonging. That acceptance eventually evolves into celebration. that when I meet someone different from me, I can delight in their difference, find moments of curiosity and joy that their experience is different from mine. In the way that my friends hiking the PCT got picked up by a cowboy who, as he was driving to their stop, said, "Do you mind if we pull over so I can swim in the creek?" And they had a decision to make. Do I jump in the creek or not? Do I pause? Do I beg him to keep driving? Do I panic over the fact that maybe this is the time that I disappear from the world? And they had to learn to trust the moment. And they went on. The acceptance becomes celebration, because when we refuse to accept other people, that accept the truth that other people's lives are strange, other, different from ours, we disrupt the part of ourself that sees that difference as a reason to get defensive or hostile. Hostility is the pathway that leads to dehumanization. Dehumanization is a necessary tool of fascism. It is also the fourth stage on the 10 stages of genocide. You cannot commit a genocide without dehumanizing the people you wish to eradicate. So when you hear politicians and world leaders say people are animals, inhuman, barbarian, savages, soulless, vermin, and insects, they are placing in your imagination that those are not people, and they are strangers too strange to be welcomed. And yet, we are UUs, and we turn to our first principle. Our first principle of honoring, recognizing, respecting, and centering the inherent worthiness and dignity of every person is literally a tool that disrupts fascism. Hospitality is literally a spiritual discipline that disrupts fascism. And here at UUFNN, we have a legacy of hospitality. We heard it in the announcements this morning. We are hosting Drag Queen Story Hour. We support the Reno Posse. We have a history as a sanctuary congregation in this community supporting our undocumented siblings. And we are not perfect. And we also know that to be true. In those opening words of, we are honest enough to say that we are imperfect, that we are going to mess up, that we will not be perfect hosts. We are a community that roots itself in holding that every human being is sacred, worthy, and filled with dignity. We are an imperfect community that tries our best to move at the speed of trust, to build relationships from a place of grace, intention, vulnerability, take risks. We as a community will need to practice taking risks in our hospitality, both as extenders of it and receivers of it. We need to take the risk of messing up for the sake of building connection with the strangers in our lives. We need to accept the consequences when our intention of hospitality is not what our impact is. Maybe we extend hospitality and the person did not feel hospitable, that did not receive it at all, and we have to hear their truth. We as a community need to disrupt the dehumanizing language that is becoming normalized every day in this country, to live out our commitment to the inherent worthiness and dignity of all people. As we move into a world where hostility appears to be never ending, we must routinely ask and discern for ourselves, is this a moment where I am called to offer or receive hospitality? Is this a moment that is asking for my risk, and am I able to offer it? Is this a moment that I can say no to? Because saying a no is also taking a risk. And am I able to stand on that no with certainty and accept the response from the person I said no to? I very rarely believe in answers, but I always believe in questions. I believe in the power of this community, as we all know that this year will be inviting us to do hard things. We've already done so many hard things so far, and I believe in us to continue. And I also believe that hospitality calls us to do hard things. The work of hospitality, of welcome, is hard work, beautiful work. It is sacred work. And as Unitarian Universalists, it is a work that we are all called into. And it is in that spirit of hospitality that I call this community to reflect for ourselves as we move forward from this place. How do we become a hospitable stranger to Northern Nevada, to Reno, and to each other? Amen, and blessed be, and namaste.
thank you to the choir. UUFNN is supported entirely by the generosity of our congregation. And as you know, a free religion isn't cheap. As we receive from this fellowship, so we give our financial support for its work within our own community right here and for the work we do in the larger community. For those who are physically here in the great room, we will be passing the basket. For those on Zoom, you can make your offering virtually by texting 73256, putting UUFNN in the message box, and hit send, then follow instructions. You can also mail a check to the office at 780 Del Monte Lane, Reno, 89511. And here at UUFNN, speaking of the work we do in the larger community, each month we share half of our plate offering with a local nonprofit. This month's recipient will be We've Got You, and its director, who will be with us next week, isn't available today, but Lily Egan will fill us into the work of We've Got You.
Good morning. It's actually I Got You, not We've Got You. And in case you want to look it up, the website is igotyoureno.org. And what this organization does is they're kind of a stopgap for anybody that's experiencing something temporary that they had really no control over, and they find themselves in a financial crisis. They don't ask any questions. It's very accessible, and mostly they deal with home furnishings, furniture, but from their website, I see they do other things as well. And I actually, after reading about them, saw something on my next door. Someone posted something that sounded perfect for this nonprofit. So I wrote back to them and they were able to get a hold of them. So the special aspect of them seems to be they're instant. And we will learn more about it. The woman in charge and her husband and her daughter are violently ill today, so they spared us coming here. Anyway, she will be here next week. And I just want to make one comment in response to something that Nathan talked about. If any of you are looking for a volunteer opportunity, please contact the Humane Society. They are desperate. My husband is practically working there full time. So thank you.
I want to invite you all to bless our offerings with me and Mary Gale. to the work of this fellowship, which is helping more people grow in love, faith, justice, and joy, we dedicate ourselves, and these are offerings. As we bring our time together for a close, I see that our chalice has already extinguished itself. I invite you all to imagine that there is a flame here. No, I'm kidding. But we remember, though, even though the light of this chalice has been extinguished, the light it guides us lives on in our hearts. And so as we carry ourselves out of this place, and this is not the benediction, we'll do a song, then the benediction, but I invite you to carry the light of this community with you. And with that, I invite you to please rise in body or spirit for our closing hymn, number 188, Come, Come, Whoever You Are.
Hello, friends. We're going to do something different. We're going to be doing a round. So the hymn is very short. It's fairly short. And we're singing it as the first verse we're all singing together. And verse 2, let's have this row come in first. And then this row does not come in until they get to number 3. But by then, you're going to be singing number 1 when they get to number 3. Does that make sense? So basically, this group becomes the round. And I'll be cueing everyone, and the choir will be supporting you as well. So sing confidently and be watching out for me. Thank you.
Please remain standing for the benediction in body or spirit. And I want to invite you all to take the hand of your neighbor. And if you're uncomfortable holding hands, I invite you to place your hands over your heart to join us in spirit. These are the words of the Reverend Dr. David Breedman, adapted for our service today. Let us be the hospitality we crave, open hearts and open arms outstretched. Let's embody radical hospitality, discerning and celebrations of love. Let us be the hospitality we crave, deeply hearing voices and hearts. Let us be the hospitality we crave, enriching understanding. Let us embody the community we crave, for though our worship has ended, may our service begin. Amen, blessed be, and namaste. Thank you.